Oh, Neil, it's been a very busy few days indeed for both of us.
Yes, but yeah, you've been running around London, I hear.
Yes, I'm pretty exhausted, and you might hear it in my voice, so I apologize for that. But all good came out of it. Went to the big JW protest, which is the protest by ex-Jehovah's Witnesses against the Jehovah's Witnesses at their big district convention in London at the XL. But before we start, you've got some things to tell us.
I've just been working unusual on my Brexit stuff on Reason Now, but today I'm heading down to the BBC.
Ooh.
Yeah, so it should be interesting. There's a protest going on outside BBC this afternoon.
Yes.
Well, it'll be in the past, obviously, by the time you listen to this. Humanist UK are protesting the BBC because on Radio 4 there's a programme called Thought for the Day.
Yeah.
And people around the world might not know about this programme, but where it is, they invite religious people on of all persuasions to talk about often nice messages, not normally quite nice, sweet messages. But the UK identifies as 50% and plus non-religious people, yet the BBC are refusing to let non-religious people host Thought of the Day. BBC is a public broadcaster. They have a remit to
surprised by this. I mean, surely just one humanist, you'd think, occasionally.
Yeah, exactly. Well, they have all faiths on there. I mean, they're not discriminatory. They will allow any faith on there pretty much for their Thought of the Day, but they will not allow non-religious points of view. So in a country that is, as I say, over half of people identify as non-religious and non-believers, BBC is a public broadcast and has a remit to represent the whole country. So we're going to be protesting today, and I'm going to hopefully get some video footage for the show.
Yes, that would be fantastic. So a lot going on in London to do with protests and things. And before we start, I just wanted to give a big shout out to Teddy Hose, who I interviewed just recently. He was an ex-Moonie. He was just on the A&E show, which is Cults and Extreme Belief. And I think I said last week that when we were talking about the interview, we were talking about the splinter group, the Sanctuary Church. That was the church which is famous for having brought AR-15s into the ceremony. I said that they were blessing the guns. Teddy corrected me on that. That was actually a marriage recommitment ceremony where they were required to bring the guns as a symbol of the rod of iron, which the Book of Revelations speaks about, as a weapon against the enemies of God. So Sean Moon, who runs this splinter church, he's a big gun fanatic, basically. And just any chance to get guns involved in his version of the Unification Church, he's going to do it. Although I wouldn't put it past him for blessing the guns. It certainly looked like that, but that was a blessing ceremony, but blessing the marriages, not the guns. But it was still weird that they had guns in
it was extraordinarily
in the church.
Weird. But great to have the clarification, because we want to be honest on this channel. We don't want to put any slant on the reality of things that happened. And actually, that was reported as in many outlets as the guns being blessed.
Yeah, it looked that way.
So it's good to have that clarification.
Though it might have given Sean Moon some ideas, so look out for the future that they might actually be blessing guns and sprinkling holy water on it. I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know about that. But yeah, that's done very well. Oh, and another thing that Teddy told me is that on the new Sacha Baron Cohen program, Who is America?, which you've got to see if you've not seen this. This is not a hidden camera program as such. This is where Sasha dresses up as different characters and speaks to eminent politicians and people like that, and then basically catches them out in bigotry and all kinds of things. It's hilarious.
It's amazing what people would do on camera. I just cannot believe saying the N-word, sticking their bare butt out.
You got to see it. It's amazing. But he said, if you look at the beginning, the opening title sequence, there's this whole sequence of shots that go by very quickly, and there is a shot of the Sanctuary Church and the congregation holding those guns. It goes by very quickly. And that's you know, how prominent that is in the States at the moment.
Yeah, it's, well, I don't know. Is Moon one of these people who believes in sort of like the end times and getting your bunker at the end of the world? Like a lot of evangelicals have got their bunkers full of guns and they're just waiting to rise up. Are the
well,
similar?
Reverend Moon, I don't think so. Well, he's passed away now, but Sean, who's leader of the Sanctuary Church, they are hoarding up guns.
So they are waiting.
They think the general public are going to come get them. It's that typical sort of paranoid mentality of the, you know, the survivalist sort of mentality.
Could end up being a self-fulfilling prophecy.
Yeah, I don't know if it's an end of the world thing, but it's like they're going to come to get us, and that's something which Teddy, of course, is out now. is very much campaigning against. You know, yeah. People are going to be hurt. There are kids that are being taught how to use these guns, you know.
Yeah.
For what? Okay, and we're going to go on from that to the Jehovah's Witness protest, and this was JW Protest UK was the official name for that. This was organized by the amazing Louise Good, who I interviewed on the channel just recently, and she has a podcast called JW Community Podcast. Now, this was a very peaceful protest. It was all organized with the police, with everyone. They all knew that we were coming. And it's at the Excel Arena in London, which is a big convention center near Docklands, so way over on the east. The plan was to make it the biggest protest ever. And I think in England, only maybe 20 or 30 people have done this kind of thing before. But well over 100 people turned up.
They flew in from all around the world.
All around the world. My fellow YouTuber, Meg Slaymaker, who's got a wonderful exJW YouTube channel, she came all the way over from Alberta, Canada. And I met her at the airport. Yeah, we went to the protest and everything was just fantastic. The idea was to have our signs and everything. We were put behind like a barrier. So we're kind of cordoned off a bit, just over to the side. And the idea was that the banners, which were quite big, they were talking about the blood doctrine, the two witness rule, which protects pedophiles, all the abuses, which not just they, but so many others have endured. That was really to educate the public, but also the Jehovah's Witnesses themselves that were in this all day, actually all weekend conference, and would at some point come out for like lunch at 12 o'clock, nice sunny day, they want to come out and sit outside. And of course, at the end of the day, they would come out and go to the trains or whatever. And the idea is they at least maybe look over and see.
It was interesting because I was having this discussion recently at the local humanist group and someone brought up, but aren't paedophiles in all big organisations where you have access to children? And it's a good point. There are paedophiles.
Some people, did they say this to us? Some of the public said that to us.
They do. So they see, why are you treating these people differently? Well, the point here is that there was in the UK recently, there was some football clubs were accused of having paedophiles teaching kids. The difference being, the Jehovah Witnesses, the Catholics famously, they protect the paedophiles. Now, the question was, aren't the number of paedophiles the same across all organisations? Any organisation where you get access to children, aren't the number of paedophiles the same? And everyone was agreeing, obviously. But the fact of the matter is, that's not the case, because in other organisations, when it's uncovered, it is tackled, and it's tackled hard by the law, and rules are changed to stop it happening again. Whereas in the Catholic Church and the Jehovah's Witnesses, they are actually physically protecting people. Paedophiles know they will be protected in those organisations and less likely to be brought to task
because
by
the Bible.
Exactly.
It goes back to that, which is what some of them told me.
It is very important that the ordinary man on the street gets this message that, this is much more prevalent in these organisations than it would be in any other organisation.
And they've got a rule, their own rule, which is the two witness rule, but that is based on biblical doctrine, which I think was from Deuteronomy. It all goes back to the Bible. And unfortunately, if you saw any of the footage of the Jehovah's Witnesses being, you know, brought to account during the Australian Charity Commission hearings, they said, well, are you going to change this? And they said, no, we're not going to change it. Just blatantly said.
Yeah, and they're breaking the law in America right now.
Because it's the Bible.
Exactly. And in America right now, they are being fined on a daily basis because they have a list of thousands of elders that have been accused of paedophilia, and they are refusing to hand that list over to the police. Now, the difference being in my head that when you see these sort of stories elsewhere, the police get involved, and they will get a warrant and they will go in and they will get that. They will raid it and get that information. But because these are religion, yet again, people are scared to get involved. People are scared. I don't understand how this isn't seen by the public as paedophiles being protected. If it happens in a football club, if it happens in a school, there will be police swarming all over that school, and the people that few people that have been doing the protecting, they will go to jail just as much as the actual perpetrators of the offence. Whereas the people who are hiding paedophiles in the Catholic Church and the Jehovah's Witness, which we're talking about today, they're walking around scot-free. They're the top dogs.
This is the problem. People don't know enough about it. In fact, at one point, I was hovering around either taking footage out amongst the Jehovah's Witnesses and also the public, trying to get as many interviews as possible, and that's going to come up, video from that. I was also behind the barrier. I was interviewing the protesters and all that, and I asked them, so how is this going? What's happened? And I was told one story. I had missed this because I wasn't there. I was away filming. That someone came up to the barrier and they saw that this big banner, and it actually said, you know, JW.org protects pedophiles. All he saw was protect pedophiles. He thought, why do you say that? And they said, no. The Jehovah's Witnesses doctrine protects pedophiles. And it turns out this guy is a shadow hunter. I know that sounds like something out of a comic book, but what that is somebody who goes and roots out pedophile rings and brings them to justice. And he confessed he didn't know it was that bad within this organization. And he asked a lot of questions, and then he went away and he said, I'm going to look into this.
Yeah.
So that's just one of the many amazing things which happened on that first day.
Many people don't know how bad this is. And one of the messages that the protesters have been putting across, because it was a very polite protest. I mean, as angry as this subject makes me.
That was the idea, to be peaceful and loving to these people and to educate them and the public.
Yeah, and one of the messages was, you told me earlier, which is fantastic, is they're just saying to Jehovah's Witnesses that have children, be careful, protect your child. They are at danger in your organisation. And I think that's a very powerful message. I think it's a very powerful message to say to people, just be careful, they are in danger. Because they're going to ask why in that case, and you can just have a discussion about it. I mean, every fibre in me wants to scream and shout, but it doesn't work with many people.
No,
but
because they were told, I was told that they, the JWs in the convention, were probably told, you know, don't go out that Western concourse, you know, don't look at them, don't engage with them. And that's what everyone expected, because that's what happened before. You know, don't look at the apostates, they're in the grip of the devil, blah, blah, blah. And I was actually expecting that myself. But when they came out, all dressed to the nines as they were, they would look over, a lot of them looked at the banners in confusion. A lot were like, what, protest? Protesting us? What? And some of them would wander over. Some would scoff and have that sort of like, huh, what are you doing? That kind of thing, very haughty and arrogant. But others, good on them, actually went up to various people at the front of the barrier and said, what is this all about? And whether they were truly ignorant of the problems within JW.org or not, I don't know. But everyone was really impressed. This is all new to me, you know. But they who've done this before, they said they never come up to the barrier. They never talk to us. Yet they were. Like I was saying, in some cases they were scoffing. In other cases, they had a decent conversation with the protesters.
It's just great news. It's great news because you need interaction. You absolutely have to have interaction.
Yeah, and I thought, well, I've got to get some perspective of other people as well, because there were people there for, there were other conventions going on. There was the public just wandering around, going to the restaurants and like, what's this, you know? And invariably, when I spoke to just your ordinary person, they said, oh yeah, I know about Jehovah's Witnesses. And I said, do you know anything about them? I said, oh, I know they don't take blood and all that. So they know sort of the basics. And a lot of them agree that, you know, this blood transfusion thing, not taking blood into the body under any circumstances, is dangerous. So they know that. But one person I spoke to, she sort of said, hey, come over here. What's going on? And I thought she didn't know anything that was going on. I said, well, it's a protest against the abuses within the Jehovah's Witnesses organization. And she said, you know, I grew up Jehovah's Witness and I was abused, but the elders did go to the police and it was taken care of. So leave these people alone. Now, I didn't know how to take that, you know, really. But you walk away and you think, well, okay, perhaps you did have two witnesses, but that is very rare.
Yeah, it's very rare. This is the whole problem with the two witness rule. You have to have two witnesses to the alleged crime for them to be willing to take it forwards. Otherwise, it just gets documented.
The Bible says that.
Shoved away.
Yeah.
So that's the problem with the two witness rule. And I guess, what is the... what is the object of the protest? Is it to get the Jehovah's Witnesses to change the two witness rule?
Well, I think it's just really just to educate. Mostly, I think, is the public first, you know, and the Jehovah's Witnesses themselves second. Because like I say, we didn't expect them to take any notice of us because they would have been instructed not to take any notice of us.
Yeah.
But I mean, ultimately, it is to change the policies of the Watchtower, which is their organization, or JW.org. I think ultimately, yes. Yes, it's to make them think and perhaps have some come out.
Because they do change the rules.
Yeah.
I mean, they need a cleansing. They need to get these people out of their organization if they want, if they don't want to be thought of as a cult that protects paedophiles.
Yeah.
And they have changed other rules before, so there's no reason they couldn't change the two witness rule. They've changed the blood rules many times. Mm. There's no reason they couldn't change the two.
Yeah, yeah. At one point, you couldn't take blood into the body. I think this has only been from the 1940s. They came up with it.
But before that, you could.
Yeah, yeah, you could. I don't know who came up with it, but now they say you can have certain blood fractions. That's fine. That's okay. So because, you know, people were dying, so they had to change it a little bit. I have to mention, by the way, the Facebook group, the Vast Apostate Army, who were largely responsible for this protest and were there with their banners and their T-shirts and their stories, of course. And they did a great job, and Louise is part of that. And so big shout out to them.
And you're going to have some interviews coming up.
Yes, yes. I got a lot of video on the day. I was basically wandering around behind the barrier and in front of the barrier. I was talking to the protesters. I was talking to JWs, those who would speak to me. Most of them wouldn't speak to me, and the public in general. And it was a great day. It was a great day, and really an eye-opening day. We were also going to talk about these JW assemblies. People are thinking, well, why does a church go to a convention several times a year? So this was a district convention. This was at the Excel. It's some big arena. It could be a football stadium. And they used to pack these things out, but the numbers are dwindling, apparently. So the arenas they're choosing are getting smaller and smaller. But Excel is still pretty big. This was on the 11th and 12th, and it's also on the 18th and 19th. And I thought it'd be interesting to play a bit of audio from JW.org, which explains to the brothers and sisters, that's what they call themselves, what the whole reason for these big assemblies are.
Why do we attend large assemblies? Why is there such joy on the faces of these people? They are attending one of our assemblies. Like God's servants in the past, who were instructed to assemble three times a year, we look forward to meeting together in larger groups. Every year, we have three events: 2 one-day circuit assemblies and a 3-day regional convention. There we experience firsthand the love that unites our whole association of brothers in the world. 1 Peter 2:17. Through interesting talks, symposiums, and reenactments, we learn how to do God's will in our life. At regional conventions, costume dramas bring Bible accounts to life and teach us practical lessons. At every assembly, a baptism is held for those who want to symbolize their dedication to God. Mark on your calendar when and where the next assembly will be held, and attend it if you can.
Right, so that is the point of these things. They have talks, occasionally they'll have a movie, apparently, and they'll have baptisms, which are people jumping in what looks like a large paddling pool. And once you're baptized, oh boy, that's it. You are in like Flynn. And also they have what looks like school plays, with people dressed up as Moses and Elijah, and fake beards and all that.
You can't blame people around the world wanting to get together with like-minded people and tell stories and have a good time and stuff, but I hope it's much more interesting than the robotic voice of the guy who was explaining why you should go.
Yeah, that's very good, actually. It sounded very much like him. Yeah, I know. Well, JW.org is full of audios like that. It's very sort of like, it's almost like talking to children.
Yeah.
But they do call themselves sheep, anyway. Fair enough, you know. But so yeah, they've got a public Bible discourse. They'll have a feature film on one of the days. There'll be multimedia, all kinds of things. And there's always a for each one of these conventions, there's like a slogan or something for that particular. This year's one is Be Courageous, and that was on everyone's badge. You say Be Courageous, JW.org, and then their name. And I think that's because of what's going on you know, because of all the
challenged.
The lawsuits.
They're getting challenged more often, and I guess the congregation are now finding out about these challenges where they used to hide them from people.
So some of them obviously know what's going on with the pedophilia.
Well, it was interesting.
What's going on in Russia where they're trying to close them down?
Yeah, what was interesting for me, seeing some of the footage and that, it was actually the JWs coming out with mobile smartphones and taking pictures of the protesters and that.
Yes.
Because a few years ago, they wouldn't have been allowed a smartphone. So if they've got a smartphone, they're getting stories popping up on...
They were taking videos of us, you know, and I was assured that this doesn't normally happen, you know.
I think this is good news, because although they've got their smartphones now and they're obviously told only to go on certain websites, there's no way you're not stopping some information getting through to them. So this is why they're saying be courageous, because people are obviously becoming aware of these things that were hidden from them, completely hidden from them.
And another story, which I'll just tell you quickly, one of the protesters who was there, his name is Stefan. He was right up to the barrier, right up at the front of the barrier, and I got this on video, and I'll release this next week. So I said, anything interesting happen, you know, while you've been here? And he said, somebody came up to the convention, you all dressed up, ready to go with the badge and everything. He came up, looked at all the signs, looked at all the banners, you know, looking at all the issues, and he said, oh, you know, I've only just recently got into the Jehovah's Witness organization, but you've just reminded me about all this stuff. And he turned around and he walked away back to the train. He actually said thanks for reminding me.
Yeah, and that's all it can take with some people.
There's so many stories like that.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
Amazing. Yeah, so that was absolutely amazing. And I wasn't there for the next day, but I watched the live streams. It wasn't as big the second day. It's usually the first day for these protests. That's when everybody comes into force. And it was a great day. But I think the best video that I got is I spoke to a young man. He was only a teenager. And he was one of the only JWs that did actually agree to talk to me. The rest of them said, no, walked away. Or didn't want to be filmed at all, but he was only young. And I said, what do you think about this protest? He said, well, it's really my dad. It's not me. But if it's in the, you know, I do realize that the two witness rule is it's in the Bible. And if there are pedophiles, you know, then it goes back to the Bible. But he was clearly struggling. I mean, I showed you this bit of footage.
Yeah.
What did you think of that?
Well, he was definitely just trying to say that it wasn't the organization. It was individuals. But when you challenged him on the fact that it's in their scripture, he did struggle for an answer for that. So he was admitting in his answer, although he didn't say it was the organisation and the rules of JWs that were the issue in his answer. Well, good on him for interviewing. Maybe he'll think about it a little bit and go and have discussions with other people. Mm. He was definitely struggling. You could see his brain clicking over as he was
trying
to come
up. What about the two witness rule and Peter? And then I mentioned about the blood doctrine. What if somebody died? What if you died? What if your little brother died?
Yeah.
And again, he was like, oh, well, I agree with it because it comes to the Bible. But
I can see in a few years' time, personally, when young people like him, if he decides to stay, maybe if he doesn't come out of the organization, when they start to get in higher positions, I would imagine a lot of this harmful stuff will be dropped and from their doctrine, and they will probably get rid of all the stuff that's so controversial.
Yeah, they will have to change things. They will get what they call new light, which means a revelation that main governing body, whatever, they will get.
Well, if they want to survive, they're going to have to, because they're hemorrhaging money at the moment. They're hemorrhaging members.
They're selling off their property. They sold off the prime property in New York, which is the big, horrible, you know, watchtower building in the middle of New York.
Yeah.
And they got a shitload of money for that. And they've bought a rather nice place, a bit smaller, I think, in upstate New York, in Warwick, which is where the other protest was a few weeks back.
But I hate to use the Catholic Church as an example of where maybe the JW should do. They are quite happy to change their rules when new information, scientific information, anything comes up. They'll bend over backwards to make sure it's brought in, because they realise that if you're denying such...
Well, the Pope changes things all the time.
Yeah, so that's how they make
Which is strange, because he's infallible, which means the other ones are infallible, but never mind. It screws my head up. But as we know, the Watchtower is famously predicted the end of the world. you know, I think it was 1878, 1914, 1918, 1925, 1975. And then when those dates came and gone, they said, oh, we never said that.
Yeah.
And yet people, especially famously, I think it was 1975, who knew that this, you know, Armageddon date was coming, they would sell their home, their property, take the kids out of school.
Have they predicted another one yet?
No, I don't think they're going to do that anymore.
Well, I'll make a prediction that their church will collapse before the end of the world.
I think you might be right. Yeah, it's been a very, very interesting weekend.
And you've been busy running around. And while you were running around, congratulations, the channel has just reached 8,000 subscribers.
Yeah, thank you very much. That happened yesterday, just after seeing a screening of Apostasy.
Where you bumped into the director again?
Amazingly enough, it was so weird. I went to... Me and Meg, we went to see Apostasy. We went to see it in one theater in London. We zoomed there in a taxi. It was sold out. So we zoomed to another theater where it was showing. And we saw it there. It was my second time, Meg's first time. She loved it. She cried through it because she is an ex-JW, unlike myself. And then we decided to get something to eat. We walked down the road. We went to a pret-a-manger. And sitting there behind us was the director, Daniel Kokotajlo, who I'd met before. And I said, that's Daniel. And we sat, basically, to cut a long story short, we sat down and had a lovely talk with him for half an hour. He was just about to go and move into his new apartment and get ready, I think tomorrow, well, today now, to do the DVD commentary. Great talk with him. It was just so weird that, and it turned out he was in the same theater as we were, in the back, just sort of, you know, watching and judging the public's reaction to his film.
And we're still working hard to try to get an interview with him.
Yes. So I reminded him of that. So he gave me his email, and looks like if we can at some point, I think it would be more or less the time when the Blu-ray comes out. Because
that would be great timing, yeah, for sure.
He's really busy at the moment. He says there's emails and interviews left, right, and center. So.
Well, that won't be too long in today's cycle of films coming to DVD. That won't be too far away.
Yeah. I know the DVD itself is ready for pre-order and, of course, Amazon streaming, but the Blu-ray is not yet done, and... as we speak right now, I think he's doing the DVD commentary. That would be very interesting.
Incredibly so, yes.
Yeah, well, we don't have our usual news reports this week, but we had a lot of other stuff to talk about, and it was a fantastic weekend.
So, I've got to get down to London.
Yep, okay.
You've got to go and do an interview.
Yes, I'm interviewing the cosmic skeptic, Alex J. O'Connor.
So, we'll see everyone next week.
See you next week.